Yo, first of all, let me get this out of the way because this was my introduction to you many years ago when I first heard this shit. And where the fuck did it go, yo? Is it not on here? Yeah, a little high right now. Tajai, Souls of Mischief, carrying the culture. Fuck it, let's get it. This was my introduction to you right here, son. And this is when I lost my mind. Oh, yeah. Video was everything. The whole shit. I find it pointless smashing seas in the flames. That's like, why in my dust desert for all the kids I must have made? I trust the courtesy when dealing with folks is too much for the ass. Cool, I got the skill crafting tools. Massive rules at my workbench. My wrench and mics from their grasping. That's how it has been. The thrill's this. I kill swift. I feel I better slay ya. Hey, my day deck is great. So now I'm axing. If they saw me and they was available, would they want me in the Alamo? Be through screwdriver, crazy maybe. Nothing bold live leak.
So yeah,
I heard this shit and fucking lost my mind. I was like, who the fuck are these niggas, man? You know what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
And being on the East Coast, I was like, what is this, man? And so let's go to the beginning, man. When I interviewed A-Plus a couple of years ago, he told me you guys had a song early out. It was like some... I can't find the interview on my shit. It was like he even like spit something from it for me. It was an early track you guys had. Like he was.
Did you have been rapping together since 83. So we got a lot of stuff that has will never see the light of day.
So he spit. Yeah, so that's what he did. I gotta find it. It was like. Perpetrators or something.
Wow. Perpetrators are the ones we hate.
Yeah.
Bike from state to state. Yeah. Wow. That's all I remember. But look, this how long ago that was. No such, we didn't even know you recorded in the studio. We basically had a boom box. I got a boom box for my, what grade was that? I don't know. I got it as a gift.
You said you guys were around like 16.
No, Perpetrators is before that. It was like sixth grade. I think we were like 11 or 12.
Well, because Souls was like 16 or 17.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah. When we came up, I mean, that's when you lost. I was 17 on that, you know? So that's light years. Perpetrators was like sixth grade. I mean, it was maybe 11 or 12.
Oh, he didn't say it. It was like some youngins like that.
Yeah. And then we had a beatbox, like a boom box, and we put it on record, and we had a bowl. And we each would beatbox into the bowl to make the reverb, and then we and he'd say his rap while I was beatboxing, and then I'd go to the fake wiki wiki, and then he'd start beatboxing in his bowl, and I'd kick my rap. That's how low tech that was. That was
Perpetrators. The ones we hate.
Hey, so come out, right from state. I remember he had one rhyme. A-Plus was ill even back then. He was like, I'm the mutilator, dominator, MC Slayer, devastator. Plus, I'm greater with a fader and a perpetrator hater. Whoa. I'm talking about this is a long, that's A-Plus. I wasn't that good. I wasn't as good as him, man. He has carried me through all this. You know what I'm saying?
Big up to the homie A-Plus. That's the fucking homie right there. So big up to him. So that was early shit. So take us to the beginnings of Hiero. Like, how did that, like, just come together? Like, it was you and A-Plus were the first two, right?
Well, yeah, me and A-Plus.
As far as Souls of Mischief, I'm sorry.
Yeah. We all grew up in the same neighborhood, but we all were separate, you know? But we all went to the same elementary at first, which is Howard Elementary in East Oakland. And Casual was his own man. He was, I think, Jammin' Jay back in the days. Dell was TDK plus 30. He had, you know, everybody had different names. Opio was OL, the original lyricist, you know? Festo D was, I think, just Manifesto, you know, or Fresh D or something, you know. So this is an old, you know, old, 83, 84. But me and A-Plus, we get together and kick it, and we formed a crew. And then Dell was a couple, Dell's maybe 4 years older than us. So he was getting on. And he sort of pulled us in and started, you know, once we were allowed to take the bus and all that kind of stuff, started taking us around, brought us down to L.A. with Sir Jinx while he was working on his demo. So we did some stuff with Sir Jinx that I think I found a couple of them. So we might be able to drop those soon.
Hit me up.
If you watch the Souls of Mischief movie on Monday, I think there's like a snippet of it. But first song we did was called High Powered. I remember with Sir Jinx. That was in, we were 13 then. So that was 87 or 88. And then, so Dale had us in his crew, TDK plus 30. I mean, we used to be working with Spice One over at the skating rink in San Leandro. Casual had his own thing. And then as we sort of moved to high school, we started clicking up. So Opio joined the crew and Festo joined the crew as far as our crew. We were called Rhythm and Excellence. This is before Souls of Mischief. Yeah, I'm glad we changed our name. I mean, you can tell by the names. This is just old school, you know.
Of course. I mean, that's what it was. I mean, everyone had names, MC Fresh D and shit. I mean,
yeah,
you know, that's
what it was. I was Solid T.
Solid T?
Solid T. Oh, I'm so glad I just used my normal name. I mean,
I'm glad you used your normal name too.
And then so Casual, I remember we was like, our big partner got flows, you need to hear him. And so we had Casual and Dale sort of, you know, battle on the block type thing, but we all ended up just sort of coming together and building. And I say by maybe ninth or 10th grade, we all were a clique. So Souls of Mischief, Casual. And then by 11th grade, Pep Love, you know, he was down with J-Biz. So Pep Love and J-Biz and Dell. And so we all, by 11th grade, we were a clique. 12th grade, we were Hieroglyphics.
Were you all in the same school? Or
Dell had come out by then. You know,
were you all in the same school?
We went to different schools. So, Fest went to St. Mary's. I went to O'Dowd, and then all the other guys went to Skyline. They used Dale's address, and everybody went to Skyline because he lived in the proper district. It's, you know, they separated kind of by freeways. So, in the end, yeah, we all just sort of grew up physically in the same walking distance. I don't know if it'll be walking distance nowadays, but we used to be trooping in our travel foxes and fucking vans and shit. You know what I'm saying? Trooping, trooping.
Travel foxes. Whoa. Whoa.
Yeah. That work is hot.
Ouch. I remember, of course. So let me ask you a question. Did you guys, so, you know, your vibe is kind of different from the standard 90s West Coast vibe of whatever, you know what I'm saying, G-Funk type shit.
Yeah.
I mean, what I noticed at the two Hiero days that I went to was that, like, it seemed like all the Oakland hip-hop heads, it seemed like a lot of love in the Oakland hip-hop community. And it seemed like, did you guys have any issues coming up being, like, different from that? Or was it, like, just like, yo, these cats are doing their thing, yo, they let them rock? Were there any type of, you know what I'm saying, issues?
Nah, we grew up, man. When we grew up, it's like one hip-hop. You know, until maybe 92, hip-hop was one thing. So if you was a rapper, you listened to everything from the whack. You bought everything, even if it was whack. Like, oh, let me check out this. I don't want to name no names, but, you know, let me check out this all the way to the
you can name
and
names.
The Rakims.
You can name
and all that. Honestly, I don't got heart like you. I'll be watching your page. I'll be like, wow, he's the... I just like, you know, I just like, yeah,
you
I
like
think that
business.
Too, but
I
got to be politically correct out here.
Yo, but, you and every MC under the sun just does that. I mean, I'm just I get it. Niggas hit me up in the DM like, yo, I agree with you, but I can't. I'm like, I understand. I get it.
Yeah. But you know, it was one hip hop, so it wasn't really an issue. I mean, and then as things started splitting kind of in 90, 91, I think, you know, we had dreads, we wore colorful clothes, you know, we started wearing baggy clothes and things like that. So we probably had beef with cats who was on the turf every day. We had like the Cortez 501 starter, but that's just regular 60. We would have funk with them anyways, just not trying to be part of the crowd, you know. It didn't have nothing to do with us being rappers, you know, because they didn't want no rap beef. They wanted physical beef. And, you know, I mean, Oakland is so small, you can't really escape dealing with the streets kind of thing. But fortunately, I mean, we all very blessed to have come from good families, you know, or about education, about getting us out of the situation we were in, and about, you know, exposing us to things. So I think we're all lucky that we didn't necessarily have to go that route, you know. But I don't think that it was we didn't choose necessarily that, hey, I'm going to be like this and not like that. Hip-hop was just, that was hip-hop. You listen to everything, you know, and you wanted to be the best. So if I'm trying to beat Kane or Rakim or G-Rap or you know, LL, It's like I'm lifting with bodybuilders. I'm not just lifting with frail guys, you know, who don't push any real weight. So of course it caused us to step our lyricism up.
What influenced you guys to make the music that you did? Because, you know, like your sound coming out and, you know, obviously you heard the comparisons. You even went on tour with, you know, De La Native Tongues. You've heard the comparisons. So like, yeah. You know, which are legitimate. I mean, but like, what was like, yeah, like this is our sound. Like we're going to do it like this. Like, well, what brought that all together?
I think that really, I mean, you got to look at the KRS, Rakim, Kane, G-Rap, Chill Rob G, Lakim Shabazz, whole 45 King thing, you know, LL Cool J, and then you got De La Soul. And I think that as far as personal style, not necessarily rap style, but just personal style, the peace and love, I'm being myself. I don't care about these dudes over here in the Kangos trying to imitate whatever's hot at the time. That really spoke to me personally. So I think that we got a lot of comparisons in Native Tongues, one, because we're a crew, but then also because we had locks. We weren't necessarily always talking about street stuff or all that. But when you listen back to our records, I mean, you know, my mom gets popped in the thigh on one, you know what I'm saying? No, we talking about joining gangs on another one, you know, shanking old ladies, all kind of stuff. So it wasn't like, I think the visual presence made those comparisons a little bit more viable than the reality. You know, if I think we all came out dressed like NWA, we probably wouldn't have the success that we had. We probably wouldn't have been as true to who we were as people, but it probably would have been more accurate as to where our minds were at that age growing up in the, you know, 80s and 90s in Oakland, you know?
It's important that you mention that because A-Plus mentioned that when we chopped it up because he was saying that, like, you still came up in Oakland.
Yeah.
So regardless of the fact of whether you were doing some other shit, you were still in the hood in Oakland. So it was like, Oakland is Oakland, and I've rocked out in Oakland, so I get it. So
yeah, and that's new Oakland, '80s Oakland thing. You know, you grew up in the '80s. We all grew up in the '80s and '90s. This shit right here that they're dealing with is a walk in the park. You know,
yeah, gentrified Oakland is different.
Yeah, gentrified Oakland is different, but also just America. I mean, you know, the opioid crisis and all that, but that shit don't got nothing on heroin or crack. You know what I'm saying? No, nothing like. We grew up in some bad situations. And then on top of that, I would say that since it was post-Panthers, Oakland was hit harder than other places. You know, crack is from here. You know, heroin was pumped in here. In fact, the Panthers were getting the heroin dealers off the street, and the government didn't like that and started really pushing the crack here. So we got hit really, really hard. So it went from a place, like my family's from Pittsburgh, my dad's side. So moved from Pittsburgh. My earliest memories are driving from Pittsburgh to Oakland. And I remember my grandma got me a Spider-Man piggy bank in Pittsburgh. And I filled it up. And I remember a couple years later, somebody had cut it like an orange peel when we moved to Oakland and took all my stuff out my piggy bank and took all our Christmas gifts, like, you know, on Christmas Eve. So, you know, we was moving out here to get away. I mean, because there was prosperity, et cetera. But then when that crack hit, it changed everything.
Wow. Yeah, I didn't know that. Do you get back out here often? I mean, I know we linked up at the show last year, but do you get out here? Is your family still out here?
Oh, yeah. My a few of them have moved out here, but I still got cousins and stuff out there. I remember we did Shadow Lounge a few times, and they came through there, you know. But I see them. We have a reunion. I mean, pre-COVID, we all go to the Long Beach Jazz Festival down in L.A. So half my family, like, moved down to Long Beach and around there, and then the rest kind of moved up here, so. It's between the Bay and Long Beach, really.
Okay. I got you. Yo, did you guys expect the success of 93-2?
Yo, we were kids. We thought we would be bigger than we were. Now, I would never expect how we are now to where, you know, 30 years later, I still can live off rap if I need to, you know, if I wanted to be on tour year-round. I didn't expect that because at 17 years old, you think somebody who's 40 is dead, you know, so let alone, you know, 45. I mean, you think you got one foot in the grave at that point. So we thought we would be the biggest thing out. But also, when we're saying the biggest thing out, going gold back then was like selling 10 million records. The only guys that were selling big records were Hammer and Vanilla Ice. Aside from that, you know, if you went gold, that was like, you know, LL Cool J or Platinum.
Right.
That was like megastar. And right. So, I mean, we thought it would be big, but not in the way that it turned out. But you know, with God's timing and all, just the way things turned out, I'm very happy that we didn't hit that sort of superstardom then, because it sort of set the path for our work ethic and set the path for us to not get burnt out, you know, and played out. So I like being, you know, like the underground rapper at 40, 45, you know what I'm saying? Like, I enjoy it. I feel like I'm still the underdog. So it makes me hungry when I'm getting in the studio, when I'm trying to promote a record. You know, I'm gonna rock out shows in the middle of nowhere and do clubs and all that still, even though we, you know, we throw the biggest hip hop festival in the Bay Area, I'm still going to do all this necessary because I have the sort of underdog mentality. And I think that has to do with us not blowing up in the way that we thought we would have as kids.
Got you. Tajai, Souls of Mischief, Hieroglyphics, Carrying the Culture. If you got questions, throw them below in the question section, and Tajai will happily answer the questions if they're not dumb as shit. Yo, did you guys ever like battle each other? I've always said, I've done memes about your whole squad that said like no weak link in the bunch, man. Like as far as Hyro goes, you know, Festo, fucking everybody, Pep, like, so did you guys ever, because I was talking to Jice One from the Arsonist, he was like, they used to have this shit, like some war room shit, danger room from like the X-Men. Yeah. They just locked themselves in a room and just go at it with each other. Like, did you guys ever do that shit at all, battle each other?
You know, we're all homies, man, like close family friends and shit. Like, our kids are, we're each other's godparents and everything. So I think when it came to battling, we would do sort of cap rapping, you know, rhyme about somebody's head or something. But as far as how we sharpened our lyrical thing was just how many syllables you can rhyme. How many times can you hold this one rhyme pattern? But we didn't really go for the low blows because we you know, we're going to have to go eat lunch and hang out afterwards and stuff. So and then also battling as we came up, I think LL was really, you know, like certain dudes is really who started punching low. And I say LL and Pac and KRS, you know what I'm saying? They would really like hit you with that low, that right. They wanted to end your career. Whereas right. We look at a battle as a display of skill, you know? So if somebody has a style, you know, somebody hops in a battle with an ill style and is able to maintain that freestyle style for a long time, that to us would be like the illest. Like, yo, he was doing that Bookie Lukey style for hella long. So we didn't really... We battled each other. Anytime we freestyle, we battle. Or anytime we make record. I mean, right now, I'm trying to make a record to top Cash, Big Head Science. You know what I'm saying, though? Or A-plus, you know, the one he just did with Tech. So we still got this sort of in-crew competition. But it's not lighthearted. It's serious, but it's not something where we hit each other below the belt because we got genuine love for each other. Like, we really... you know, spend the night at each other. You know, as kids, we grew up, this is my homies. So if we weren't Hieroglyphics, these would still be my friend group. These are the dudes I grew up with on my block, you know?
Right. And I've seen the love, man. I mean, that's one thing I appreciate being around you cats. Like, you know, like I, everyone that I've talked to has been like, yo, it's more than just the music, man. We're friends, you know what I'm saying? And the friendship comes first. But that being said, who's the best? If somebody was like, yo, is there a go-to motherfucker that's like, yo, that's the number one dude?
It's different. To me, okay.
Break it down.
Think about this. I think Casual might be the best rapper of all rappers. You feel what I'm saying, though? I've seen him do things where I'm just like, wow. And if you like, he's got a rhyme in Metunetter. So he's in Hieroglyphics, rhyming in a dead language in Hieroglyphics. No rapper can touch that. There's no rapper. You can rhyme in Spanish, whatever, yada, yada. No rapper can touch that. Then I think, for instance, Festo D, like, come on, that dude is supremely ill. And he says shit where I'm just like, damn, I went to Stanford. I don't even know what you're talking about. I got to go get a book, you know, not just a dictionary, but an actual book to do some research on what you're talking about right now. You know, freestyling, everybody holds the crown at different times because it's vibe inspired, you know, but I think everybody's ill in their own way. Opio is kind of like, got his voice is the illest. You know what I'm saying, though? Dell will make an album in 3 days, you know? A-plus, they talk about producer rappers. A-plus is killing all producer rappers because he's a dope-ass producer and a dope-ass rapper. I wouldn't even put him in the same realm as the other producer rappers they'd be considering. When you think about the kind of slap that A-plus has. And then like Pep Love, that dude has a metronome in his head. He's like a machine, you know, like never off beat, never with some weird ass janky styles, all his styles, even if he switches it up or hitting right. So I can't, I'm not being
No, I appreciate you, yo. I'm asking, I put you, I threw you on the spot. I saw your eyes get big. I wanted to break down. I know you're not ducking the question. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. You're breaking it down. And that's important, because I've always looked at the squad. I'm like, yo, there's no weak motherfucker in that shit.
I appreciate that.
You know what I'm saying? There's no weak, like, I mean, I may not love every song or whatever like that, but that doesn't mean, like, ain't no weak shit coming out. And I know it's like, if it's time to fucking go, like, all you guys are ready to, bullets coming out. So, you know what I mean? So.
Gotta stay sharp, man. You know, I got this single about to come out, and man, I got a G-Rap on the remix to it. And man, you know, I got loose on the single. I'm like, woo, yo, I got loose. It's like 42 bars.
G-Rap, what the fuck is man, that shit, man?
I sent it to G-Rap. Dude, I'm just trying to get it the proper mix because I want people to hear it right. But I sent it to G-Rap, and man, it was like if Jordan came to the Rutgers, you know, and I'm dunking on cats, boom, 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 and then Jordan takes off his sweats and hops on the court, dude. So I'm saying you got to stay sharp decades. So I appreciate my clique because everybody come with it, you know?
Yo, they come with daggers, man. Yo, the whole squad comes with daggers. Big up to Cool G Rap.
Oh, man.
First of all, as I've said before, when people bring up older cats that are like, people say the older cats need to evolve to some other shit. You got D Rap, who's like 54, crushing shit.
You got to hear this new one. I thought it'd be mastered by today. I'm just waiting on the technicians, but man, G-Rap kind of wild out on this.
So now you told me about that before. You told me about it again. So now I'm gonna be fucking bugging your ass about
this. I'm gonna get to you ASAP. Hell yeah.
You're gonna be like tomorrow block, yo. Fuck out of here, man. So, yo, any crazy shit? Well, actually, one question I have before we get there is, was there a defining moment for the group, like where you guys were like, this is real. I'm assuming it's around 93 still, but like, was there a moment where you guys were like, what the fuck? Like, this is the real shit.
I would say, and I just saw a few pictures recently by Ernie P. When we went to go do the Midnight Marauders album cover, and it was all love. You know, we from the West Coast. We, you know, this is in 1993. And Tribe asked for us to be on their tour. We go out to take pictures for this Midnight Marauder cover, and everybody is there. You know, I mean, you've seen the cover, and you know, Grandmaster Flash, and you know, Bambada, you know, whatever, you know, at that time, like these cats are all like, I know who you are. What the fuck? I fucks with y'all. Like that to me, I was like, whoa, okay. We really here. We real rappers, you know, because all the real rappers were there. Like, yeah, Souls of Mischief. We know who y'all are. You know,
the OGs. Yeah, yeah. I mean, because you guys were yo, because you were 17. You said, right?
Yeah, I think at that point I had probably just turned 18. But yep.
That's wild. So big up to everybody on the IG, Apathy, Other Heads, DJ Sapphire, Friendly Traveler, all the heads joining on IG. Question button is right there. There's a little questions thing, and it says, and it just has a questions mark. So you press that, and you can enter your questions. Let me see what we got for Tajai. We'll put this right here. This is a good question. Can Tajai see that? Did you guys ever
interact with
the Woo? How do you think your respective crews stack up?
Question
from CB Wonderly.
We always interact with the Woo, man. Those is good brothers. You feel what I'm saying, though? Like, we do Rock the Bells and all kind of shit. You know, we always hit the festivals because it's a Hieroglyphics Wu-Tang thing. And I think that would be one of the illest. You know, it would be a war of attrition.
No, is that not one of the, I'm going to cut you off right now, the illest Hieroglyphics day at that point in time, that would be it. Wu-Tang.
Yeah, Wu-Tang, yeah. But I think if we had the battle, it would just be a war of attrition, man. I think it would be whoever had the most darts memorized, because what cats don't realize about the Wu-Tang is those are some street cats. You see what I'm saying, though? So they got a whole extra bag that they can pull from where they can talk that gun talk and talk that shallow. And they got a whole, the same way we got the Egyptian mythology going and all that kind of stuff and the mystery school and all that. They got the whole Shaolin Wu-Tang thing. So that'll be ill, but I think it'll come down to who got the most shit memorized. It's the second somebody break out a BlackBerry or something, then the battle will shift, you know? But they like, what the feeling that they inspire is a different feeling than what we inspire. The feeling they inspire is like when they say straight from the slums of Shaolin, you can smell that shit. Like, yeah, oh,
you,
wow.
Yo, is, you can't you know? Tell me that if you listen to, like, you know, back in 94, 95, you listen to the Wu-Tang albums that fucking you thought you was from fucking Staten House.
Man, you got to put on an army suit, really, to, you know, and unlaced Tim's to really get into it properly, you know?
And they, you know, big up to them for putting Staten Island on the map because, even, you know, I've talked about this before. No, you know, nobody even in New York fucked with fucking Staten. Even now, yo, I talked to my homegirl a few weeks ago. She was like, I ain't never been to Staten Island. She's from fucking Queens. She was like, I don't go. Nobody goes out to Staten Island. You know what I'm saying? They put that. Nobody was talking about Staten Island. As far as hip hop goes, Jersey was popping off way more than Staten Island.
Long Island, too, before
Staten Island was.
They had that chip on their shoulder, though, but you could feel it. Like, and I remember, you know, I was really in the tunnel at ODB's Return of 36 Chambers release. And all at these spots, when Wu-Tang was coming, it was like, here comes, it was like Genghis Khan and the Mongols were coming. You know what I mean? There was 30, 50, 100, like 100 deep, not 30. You know, New York cats
were clubs.
They were like, okay, we going to the tunnel, 100. And then they
do that. You know, if you're in the tunnel, you know, the shit is grimy, it's long, narrow, like so you was there for that.
Yeah, man. So, I mean, big up Wu-Tang, man. I don't think any, like, they ill, man. We're just trying to keep our legacy up the same way they're doing it, man. But you look at a guy like Ghostface, who I say would be like G-Rap, maybe next generation. You feel what I'm saying, though? Like, ain't never made a misstep. Still one of the illest rappers, period. And he's in his 50s, too, you know? So we just got to keep pushing, man. Fortunately, with rap, your knees don't get old. You know, it don't matter if you get blind. It doesn't matter if you get gray. As long as your voice is ill and your breath control is up and your mind is not addled by whatever, drugs or whatever, you're able to contend with whoever.
Exactly. No, that's dope, yo. Tajai, Souls of Mischief, if you got questions, put them in the questions feature below because I am not looking at the comments otherwise. Apathy got a question. We'll throw it in there real quick. Who had the idea?
Oh, wow. What's up, Apathy? How you doing, my brother? Man, I don't know who had the idea to kick each other's verses. I just think we were like, yo, we got to make this remix different. And so on, I think the first single was That's When You Lost. We just kind of changed the beat up. And we always used to do a B-side. And I think at that point, we had just like, let's do something different. And also, I think during shows, sometimes we'll be like, yo, can I kick this one? You know, so it was a spur of the moment thing, but I think it made one of the illest remixes because it just nobody had done it before, you know? It was damn near like some jazz shit where, you know, the horn plays the sax part and the sax plays the bass part or whatever. So it was more like an in and out jazz thing. And I'm glad we did it.
Dope. Yo, so you got a bunch of other shit going on, man. And like, I wikied you and all that shit. And I was like, you know what I'm saying? So you graduated from Stanford, right? Was it anthropology, right?
Yeah.
And you're an architect now. So
yeah,
that's
yeah. You see my fit. I'm coming straight from the job right now. But yeah, man, I felt like it was about, ooh, I was 30. 35 maybe, so mm-hmm. about 2010, maybe 2009, and I looked around, I was at a show, and I was at the after party, it was in Switzerland or something, I can't remember, and I was like, man, I'm the oldest dude here, you know, and at that time, you know, to me now, I'm like, 35 is young, whatever, youngster, you know, live your life, but at that time, I was like, you know what, I could be doing more, and I had a camera on me. And I went outside and started taking pictures of just the landforms and the buildings and stuff. And it turned into my portfolio. So eventually I applied to Berkeley for architecture. And also my kids were getting into high school age and I didn't want to be touring as much. So I said, you know what, let me do something where I need to be around. And I went to grad school for that. And I've been designing now since 2014, man. I build houses, restaurants, clubs. You know,
you got your firm like took over some big ass hotel or some shit. What was the
oh,
No, I bought a hotel. I bought a hotel down in Panama, man. So it's like, it's not big though. It's like 19 rooms. It's on the beach. It's like bungalows. And I'm trying to do, that's my retirement plan, man. I'm going to build a recording studio there, build some pottery and art studios, maybe start throwing festivals on the beach and stuff. But that is like the artistic mixed with the architecture, mixed with the fact that rappers don't got no 401k, man. We got to do something. So, yeah.
Respect for being a well-rounded brother, man. I mean, I really appreciated like reading that and was just like, wow, okay, like, you know what I'm saying? I always knew, you know what I'm saying? Actually, my man, big up Cali Vegas. He was like, I posted the one joint. It was a black and white joint you did. I don't know. It was like just some freestyle you did recently.
Uh-huh.
He was like, yo, this brother's vocabulary. And I was like, there's a reason for that. And so, yo, you speak Swahili?
Yeah, nazungumza Kiswahili. Kidogo.
Yo, can you say that shit trash being Swahili?
Oh, God.
Come on, try.
I'm gonna send it to you.
All right.
Nimbaya sana. That just means it's very bad. Nimbaya sana.
Nimbaya sana?
Yeah, or hiki ni kibaya sana.
You got something worse? You know my page. I need something.
I unfortunately learned Swahili in school. Maybe if I was in jail, like most of my
you gotta
homies,
go to the hood. I need the hood Swahili. The gully. So it's very bad. What is it?
Kibaya sana. Mbaya sana. Mbaya sana. Mbaya sana.
All right. But I'm about to rant. Mbaya sana B. Maybe that'll help add the shit to it. Yeah. Fuck it. All right. So, yo, rap noir, what's that all about, man?
So rap noir is, you know, you think of film noir, you think of like a Dark Knight comic, you know, or the, what is it, Sin City, man. Basically, you know, I'm around all types of people, you know what I'm saying? What they say, from the crack house to the White House, I got a whole gamut of friends, you know? And so I would see a lot, and I wanted to create really a concept and a genre where it was not confused as me trying to go gangster or be a gangster or make necessarily gangster rap. And so I thought of this concept of rap noir, you know? And so I've got this character, Black Hoodie, who's basically sort of a three-eyed executioner, you know? So he's just a narrator. But I'm careful, I created the rap noir concept and the Black Hoodie concept so that I could touch on these things without people looking at it like, oh, Tajai thinks he's hard or something. Nah, I'm a soccer dad. I draw buildings for a living and, you know, wear Birkenstocks. You know what I'm saying? So I want this genre. People got to understand the genre.
Yeah!
It's a genre. You know what I mean? I got a movie now coming, a rap noir movie. We're going to film with the album as a soundtrack. And then I actually have my little homie, Know-It-All. I mean, my young homie. He's not my little homie. But he produced it with a sort of modern beat. So for me, rap noir is me and Unjust, the group. And Unjust makes a lot of sample heavy, just cinematic style beats. And that was bringing sort of these crime stories out of me. Then I gave my acapellas to the young homie and we created trap noir, which is like a more contemporary version of it. But it's weird because I've gotten a lot of new young fans from the trap noir version, like where they don't get the, not they don't get it. They just don't know the concept behind it. Like this is Tajai from Souls of Mischief. And how
you're just trap noir.
They're just like, oh, this group is dope and oh, I like this shit. And then if you listen to it over the other beats, it does sound more like some gangster shit. But I just want people to understand rap noir is not just a group, it's also a genre. You know, so all you studio gangsters out there, instead of trying to perpetrate like y'all hella hard and tatting your faces and all that, just say I make rap noir. You know what I'm saying? No, it's dark rap, you know, like you don't have to front and get yourself in trouble trying to be something you're not.
So you're just sharing that shit, but it's not defining you as you're saying that's who you are.
I hope people get that because I think there's this push where it's like, keep it real. And like, we're not wondering where, like if Scorsese has work in the streets right now, we're not worried about, you know what I'm saying though, if Francis Ford Coppola really shot somebody or anything like that. We're directors and actors and things like that. You know, I think when you think about the Rick Ross affair, when he had to sort of lie about his past being a CEO or whatever, to me, he shouldn't have to do that. He should be like, yeah, I was a prison guard. Motherfuckers got jobs out here, but I make the dopest gangster shit out. You know what I'm saying? And who knows? He might've been a mule or something as he worked in the prison. Who knows? But the need for a grown man to lie about gainful employment or about their real life is completely insane to me.
I appreciate you saying that, man, because there's no no shame in working a 9-to-5 or whatever it is. You got to make ends meet, whatever it is. So I appreciate you saying that for aspiring MCs who are trying to still do this, for older MCs who are like, still, like you said, there's no 401k in hip hop. So like, of course, man. And it's like, it's crazy. And that is, but we do glorify keeping it real though. So the thing is, be honest though. Like that's the problem with shit though. Like you don't have to front. Like I'll appreciate you more. Like I appreciate you more because you're Tajai, the Birkenstock architect, spitting nigga from Souls of Mischief versus the, you broke
a gotta mess. Be comfy. You gotta be comfy out here, man. I'm a sneakerhead too, but I wear those on stage. You know, every day I'm Crocs and Birkenstocks.
Crocs and Birkenstocks. You do a rhyme about that shit, yo. Crocs and Birkenstocks. I'll do the hook. Yo, here's the shit for Rap Noir right here. This is my shit. I saw this live in Pittsburgh. This is my shit. So the Bluetooth went off. But so we're gonna get this on in a minute. But Rap Noir. So are you like trying to push that hard, or like you got some merch coming out, right?
Yeah, I got that project, the Rap Noir project. I'm making a movie. We got our next album is called Black Hoodie Chronicles, and it's basically going to be almost like the game of life with crime. So every song is going to be a crime, and hopefully I start off broke at the beginning of the album and end up with some money in my pocket or whatever at the end of the album. But you know, it's going to be crime stories. You know, I think Guilty Simpson's going to be on. You know, I'm trying to get the real heavy hitter, so I'm think Guilty is gonna get on there, and a few other cats, man. I'm trying to get to bust some of that good street shit, you know. So I'm continuing with the Rap Noir concept and group, of course. Then I also have a record. Me and the Architect have a record called Black Tech. So that's TNA or Tajai and the Architect, and that's the next one we're about to drop.
What time? I need a time frame so I can be up your fucking ass about this.
Single should be. Hopefully before September 30th, you know, this month, the new single. I'm just trying to get the cuts and get the mix right for the one, and that's going to be Scattershot, and then we got the Scattershot Ghost Recon version with me and G-Rap. That's the next single, and then the Black Tech album comes after that, man, and it's ill, man. I got some good features on there. I couldn't hold the G-Rap inside of my body, man. I was like, I got one with G-Rap!
I need it. We need that. Yo, so now that I know, like, you told me about it before, but I need that shit.
I'm going to send it to you, but I need you right now in front of everybody. I'm going to text it to you. You can listen to it because you're my man. You feel what I'm saying, though? But you can't play it for nobody until it's out because I don't want anybody to hear it and it's not in its final form. But I'll send it to you because you
send it to me. As soon as the call's done, I'm gonna hit you about it. First of all, though, nobody in this industry can ever say that I've played a track without permission, and nobody will ever be able to say that. My record with that shit is solid. If it's for my ears only, it's for my ears only. People don't hear it, and that. No, that's it. So nobody can ever say that, and you will never be able to say that either. So now I'm gonna hit you after this shit.
I got you.
Where my G rap, Tajai? Here we go. Hold on, this is my shit. Don't make it so high. Rap Noir, different type, Tajai, Souls of Mischief, got some weed. Go.
Everybody say hi to the bad guy. What can I say? I've got the half mind. See, I'm on the rise, got my eyes on the prize. See, what we try, usually they stand live. I'm a bust about this muster, man. It's better cheese. We clicked up just like the men and cheese. With the first risk takers into felonious capers. All my dogs got their papers. Check the pedigree. Roscoe K. Weights and pinches. They know the small fish they fry don't make a difference. You want to need to know basis. What you need to know dangerous. And a couple loose words to build the case against faces. They can eat a dick, man. They all fat. They make any attempts, then we all black. Ain't no squealing, ain't no telling. Fuck the screaming and the yelling. We just squeezing. If you hit, it's a job hazard. Shit getting heavy in the streets now. The niggas ain't just settling for no beat yet. They're creeping up on fools, man. Beef is what they do. So I keep a couple goons on speed dial. Prime and ready for the murk maneuver. Don't waste your breath praying they'll be merciful. they vet and they season and they get down.
Like, get out of luck, nigga!
That ain't how I run my operations. Let's just say I'm in the proper place. If it moves, we don't pump it. If it don't, we go dump it. Ain't that something in business? Only the product change. So I keep a wide range in my stash house. I don't just push weight, I'm maxed out.
Yo, you a tall ass nigga, so that shit was scary as hell seeing you with that mask on, son.
Yo,
I was like, yo, this nigga's like 9 feet tall, man. Like,
I'm trying to make him like Jack from Nightmare Before Christmas, you know?
Yo, that shit was scary as hell. Your leg stretched out into the crowd, son. I was like, yo, this nigga long, man.
Man, it's crazy because I got a whole different fan base for that, man. It's damn near like some goth hop shit. You know what I'm saying?
Boy,
like
I can imagine. A
whole different fan base.
That's dope, though. I can imagine because, you know, not everybody's rocking with that shit. And I get it. I mean, I don't love every track on there, but I was telling people about this. I appreciate it. Like, you stepped out of your outside of yourself and, like, I can appreciate the solid effort and thought that you put behind the project. Like, I get it. Like, I get what you're trying to do. And I think, like, that's important. Like, so that's what's dope to me. Like, it's a dope project, man. You know what I'm saying? I fucks with it.
And thank you, man. Definitely fucks I appreciate with it, man. The next one we trying to make even better, dude. And then I'm also working on a project with Breakbeat Lou right now, man. It's tentatively called The Hop. And basically, you know, we grew up with hip-hop. Like, we would go to the party and sweat our clothes out because we was dancing, right? I mean, you know, before everybody started smoking big fat-ass blunts, you know what I'm saying? No, we would go dance. I mean, it started with b-boying, and then we'd be in there doing all kind of crazy moves. So this one, me and Lou are trying to just bring the movement, the hop, back into hip-hop, man. So that we got about six done now. I know we got one with Lizette Melendez, a crazy, like, almost freestyle
what?
Fighting shit. Yeah,
what?
Yeah.
What?
Yeah, I got some hip house shit on there too. I'm working on, man.
What?
I got some new Jack Swing. I'm trying to, you know, just do to me. Okay, in 91, I was 16, and I would say 88 is my favorite year of rap, right? But I would say after 91, shit started splitting up, and you know, we had the stoner rap, we had East Coast grimy rap, we had West Coast gangster rap, we had West, you know, fly cat rap, and then Polo kind of rap, you know, us Jiggy, you know what I'm saying? No, like. And then it went to the Ice Age and, you know, all this kind of stuff. And it sort of split up. So I'm trying to just take it back to the hip hop I grew up on and love without making them throwback shit. Like, I'm not necessarily into trying to make music that sounds like anything in the past. You know, we already sampling. So, of course, it's going to sound like something in the past. But I'm trying to make new music, you know. And that's what I think a lot of times you see guys who are like, I'm trying to bring the feeling back. And it's like, you can't bring that same feeling back. We're not in that era. Just bring the vibes back, and hopefully somebody will feel the way that you felt. But don't, like, I'm not trying to, like, have, like, old school rap styles and shit like that. Nah, I'm a current and new rapper, so I'm not going to do it like that, you know?
No, that's dope. Yo, I'm going to ask you right now, so because I like to be ahead of things. It's 9:50. They're going to cut us off at 10. Yeah. Do you have a few more minutes to go? Because they're going to cut us off, or you would have to jump back on.
I'll jump back on, man. It's only 6:50 here.
All right. So, yeah, it's a little different here. So, we're going to shut the show down, and then I'm going to jump back on in, like, a couple of minutes. Tajay's going to get back on. We're going to run it back. Right, so, you good with that?
Yes, sir.
All right. Thank you very much. Everybody come back.
TV. And they were like, there's a new type of rap, hardcore rap. Including groups like NWA, EPMD, and Eric B. and Rakim. And I was like, we was like, huh? Like, they just was all rap to us. Like, even NWA, that was their gimmick. But it wasn't like there was this genre of hardcore rap. NWA was niggas with attitude. Obviously, they gonna shoot some shit and, you know, sell dope and do all this kind of shit. But it wasn't, I think that we have been, for marketing reasons, they created these genres. And we can get into this whole Western concept where in the West, I think they put things in these little jars and they can tell you.
Crews get the same because we blame them for fighting. Might win if you start writing and stop fighting. I'm talking. rhyme for days. I rearrange my vocals in your headphones. I go till I get an answer, acknowledging and abolish all the whack records. Hieroglyphics get no respect. Who got the hall? Who got the floor? If your friend, there's no need for a law.
I didn't even see. I went to the back. Hold on, let me see. I'm gonna jump. I'm gonna go out right now. Hold up, son. I got it. Tajai and fucking G-Rap. I gotta hear this. I like hearing some quote unquote odd couple shit. Cause here's what I say, yo. And let me ask you this. This pisses me off. This is me just venting to you. I do these head-to-head battles on my page, like this, you know, fictional shit against, you know, putting cats up against each other. And then people come on my page and be like, yo, they're not similar enough. And I'm like, yo, if niggas was spitting, if niggas had to spit, right? If G-Rap ran up on you, or you ran up on somebody or whatever, like whoever it is, if you're a spitter, you're a spitter. Like, I don't understand like that. They're not too similar. They're too different to compare, man.
I think that's I think the industry has succeeded in making us think in terms of genre. When we were young, we basically picked out if you look cool on your cover, we were gonna buy it no matter what it was, hip hop. But it was all hip hop. There was one section. It wasn't hardcore, in fact the first time me and A Plus even heard the concept of hardcore, we were watching MTV. And they were like, there's a new type of rap, hardcore rap, including groups like NWA, EPMD, and Eric B. and Rakim. And I was like, we was like, huh? Like, they just was all rap to us. Like, even NWA, that was their gimmick. But it wasn't like there was this genre of hardcore rap. NWA was niggas with attitude. Obviously, they gonna shoot some shit and, you know, sell dope and do all this kind of shit. But it wasn't. I think that we have been, for marketing reasons, they created these genres. And we can get into this whole Western concept where, in the West, I think they put things in these little jars and they can tell you exactly what their name is for that, what's inside the jar, but they really have no fucking idea what's inside of that jar, you know? So if you look at the terms in terms of knowledge and Western knowledge, it looks like a huge laboratory with jars and jars of everything, math, science, happiness, beauty, race, all these different things. And they're just little jars with little, you know, like a pantry almost. And if you really ask the motherfucker who was tending to that shit, what is that though? They'd be like, it's what it says on the jar, but they really have no fucking idea. And that's the same thing they do with the music, man. You know? And so I think that people who, when they say you can't compare this rapper to that rapper, what the fuck do you mean you can't compare this rapper to that rapper? You know, it doesn't make any, it only makes sense in the context of you can't think outside of what you've been fed as genres and difference, you know? Like, I understand you can't compare maybe their vocal tone or some shit, you know, but as far as their bars, but I mean, you put up Munch and Chino, and I saw a lot of people being like, well, Chino's got this in my, but I'm just like, okay, but bar for bar, who got it, you know? And that would be like, dude, I would pay to watch that, you know?
You lock these cats in a room. If you're an MC and hip hop is one of the most competitive things out there, it's the only genre of music, as far as music goes, the rap shit. Well, actually, on every level, b-boying, DJing, it's all competitive.
Yeah, that's what it's based on. And
so the whole shit is competitive. Yo, you telling me, especially the era that we grew up in, that cats aren't going to fucking spit? Somebody step to G-Rap, he going to be like, no, you too alternative, or you're too different, or you or G-Rap yeah, step to you, gonna you're going to be like, you're too street. You're going to be like, what? I got crazy fucking bars for your ass. Right?
Yeah,
I
mean, he's
like,
gonna bar him down either way. And the guy stepping the G-Rap is gonna go as hard as he can too.
Of course, man.
You know, he's not gonna be like, oh, I respect you and no disrespect, let me kick my little rhymes. He's gonna bust as hard as he can.
He's gonna fucking come at your throat.
He's gonna lose.
But he's gonna come.
He's gonna try his hardest.
Yo, he's gonna come. He's not gonna come on that bullshit. He's not is
I'm saying this as someone who just recently felt the wrath of G-Rap. You know what I'm saying? I was like, God damn, man. Shit, man. I thought I did well.
Right, but right.
You hear it. It's an ill-ass track. It's an ill-ass track.
Big up everybody joining in. Hand on the pump, Mad B. Breakbeat Lou just joined in. Everybody,
hey, Lou, what's happening?
Salute. Everybody put your questions for Tajai down in the question shit. We're going round two because Instagram only gives an hour limit. It's Tajai Souls of Mischief Hieroglyphics with me, Tamal, carrying the culture. fucking. So yeah, yo, talk about High Road Day, please. I really want to get into that, especially considering it's a weird year for everybody. It's all fucked up, and I want to kind of get into that a little bit. Just as far
this is the first year, right? This is year 9. So, you know, 9 is the number of completion, right? And you know, not 9 is so maybe we're ending a cycle right now. We're starting something new. So we're trying to take it in stride. We don't want anybody to be, we've seen like some social distance events and it still seemed kind of sketch. And also hip hop is vibe based. So you want people to be able to mosh and interact. You want to be able to slap five with cats and give cats hugs and all this kind of stuff. So I just think that it was best for us to do it virtually. So what we're doing is basically kind of like, we're going to show the movie, the Souls of Mischief movie, you know, and that's a good one. Then we're going to do a retrospective with some live shows and all this kind of stuff about the past 9 years. So we've had, you know, literally hundreds of different acts there. And so we're going to get their perspectives on it, get some live shows. So it's like the greatest hits with some new stuff mixed in, but it should be cool, man. It starts at 4:20 on the East Coast. So, you know, we got about 3 hours, a little bit more programming. So if it starts at 4:20 on the East Coast, y'all can roll up, fire up, watch the shit. And by the time it's finished, it'll be 4:20 on the West Coast and you can burn another one and then go to
So it's gonna be some virtual shit, right?
Yeah, yes. Yeah, it's all gonna be on Sway's Universe on his YouTube channel.
Okay. Yeah. And the thing that we worked on is gonna be on there too, part of that.
Yes, for sure. So that's part of it. Yeah, the interview with everybody, all that shit, man. So we put together. We've been documenting. Actually, Shamari, the guy who directed the movie, has been documenting it for the past. The entire time. So we got stuff from the very first one all the way up to last year. And then we got the interviews, some cool freestyles, you know what I'm saying? I'm probably going to bust some new shit from me and Tex album, you know?
I might ask you to bust something tonight before you get off in like a couple of minutes.
I'm with it. Okay, I might have to read it. Right now I'm in a heavy writing period, so it might, I'm going to act like I'm looking in the camera. But I'm cheating because I got the rhyme right here on the right hand.
Perception is everything, okay? perception is everything. Tajai, Souls of Mischief. As I've said before, please put the questions in the questions feature right here. There's a question mark down at the bottom. Friendly, I love you, but these questions are too intense for the show right now, son. I can't even, like, function like reading this shit, my nigga. I can't. Big up Friendly Traveler. This kid is a dope ass DJ. He's actually out Bay Area. He's got a show on Rap FM. He's fucking nice with
Friendly
it.
Friendly Traveler is the reason why we have hieroglyphics.com. Friendly Traveler found hieroglyphics.com and Stinky and put us on to Stinky, who originally made hieroglyphics.com in 1994, I think. And that's the reason we even have the website. Berkeley student. You know, I'm Stanford to my core. You know, because it's where you go to undergrad. It's almost like you're from where you sold dope first. So I went to Stanford in undergrad. So, of course, I bleed, you know, the crimson, you know what I'm saying, the cardinal red. But Berkeley, fellow Berkeley student, Friendly Travelers, who put us up, linked us up with Stinky.
Big up, Friendly Traveler. The question is still too complex for my brain. He's a smart-ass nigga. I think I'm pretty intelligent, but Friendly makes my head explode with questions. I love him. But I can't fuck with that question. But big up Friendly Traveler. I did not know the connection. Ill-ass DJ, beat juggling, all that shit. Got a show on Rap FM Friday nights, 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. So thank you for the fucking, you know what I'm saying, the intel on that. But I want to go back to the origins of, like, High Road Day. Like, how did that, you know, we talked about that a little bit, but I want to let some other people know, like, how did that shit just be like, yo, we're going to just have this festival?
Man, so a fan, I guess, put on our message board, Hyro Hoopla, which still exists, I recently found out, that 9-3 should be Hyro Day, September 3rd, you know, shouting out 93. And he basically said on that day, people should put people up on, you know, wear their Hyro gear and tell as many people about Hyro, you know, kick it, maybe set up a whole smoke sesh or something, play some Hyro, but basically spread the word of Hyro. And I forwarded it to Casual, and Casual was like, you know what? We about to make a whole block party that day, because 9-3 that year, this is 2012, was Labor Day. So we started, we had a block party. We had two stages, one inside with a bar and one outside. And it started with about 300, 400 people. I mean, I think Planet Asia was there.
The Grouch was there, Zion Ice, all just close homies, Mo Green, Wolfhawk Jaguar, all that. And we threw that, and it by the end of the day, it was 5,000 people there. People were standing on buildings, looking down, and it was all peaceful. We cleaned up afterwards. We had a little petting zoo for the kids and everything, and the shit just became a festival that's grown, and hopefully it'll keep growing. I mean, every year it gets bigger and bigger, you know, so I think next year, if we can get it right and properly vanquish at least what's necessary for us to be able to come together, then we should be able to have a big one next year. I mean, we've been talking to some heavy hitters, you know, and I mean, Hieroglyphics Day isn't headliner heavy, right? You know, it's really about a breadth of music and really like making like the illest mixtape, or maybe the illest three mixtapes, you know, because we got the three stages. So what we're trying to do is just get a good variety. But I mean, we do got a lot of homies in the industry, from, you know, Outkast to Eminem, The Cube, you know, to Redman and then Death Squad cast and everything. So I'm hoping that we'll have a really ill Hieroglyphics Day next year.
No, that's what's up, man. Hieroglyphics Day is always ill, and I've noticed the wide range of music, from local, you know what I'm saying, Bay Area talent to you know, middle of the road acts to, you know, cats that are on top of, you know, Smith and Wesson, you know what I'm saying, was at Hieroglyphics Day. Black
they knew album was ill, man.
Yeah. Black Moon was at Hieroglyphics Day. Black Thought, you know what I'm saying? You got your local shit too, which also put me on to a lot of artists that I, you know, wouldn't have known about if it wasn't for Hieroglyphics Day. So, and that's when I saw, there was a dude, yo, who's the dude who has like this, he has like a Super Mario sweatshirt at the Hieroglyphics Day. Like, I don't know, yo,
I work that day, so I probably get to see about 15 to 20 minutes of shows total.
He's always got this outfit. He's an Oakland institution, but there's
Mr. Fab. Mr. Fab, yeah, bright colors. Yeah, he's a gregarious character. Phil freestyler, really smart dude, man. I mean,
right.
You know, he would be a professor or something if he wasn't an MC. He might still end up being a professor. But yeah, good brother.
Yo. We're gonna go into a couple more things, because I got mad shit to cover and I'm gonna hem you up. Beef with Hobo Junction. Like
shit. That was the homies. You feel what I'm saying though? Like, we used to kick it like tough. And this is, I guess that went down in 94. So I was 18, 19 around that time. Safir is the big homie. Like, you know, I mean, Safir showed me my first Glock. You feel what I'm saying? I mean, I'm sorry to get extra niggerish on the pot, but you know, but you know what I'm saying? No, he showed me my first 40 cal. Before that, I was a nine guy, you know what I'm saying? So, you know, like, this is the big homie. And I think that he had some feelings towards Casual with Casual not showing up for some studio session or something. And so he got on the radio and just was dissing everybody, trying to air cats out, you know, and it blew up from there. And in the end, I think when you talk about the radio battle, which is a lot of more hoopla and stage and all that, to me is the definitive freestyle versus written battle, you know, where they was kicking writtens. I knew it's because we have mutual, these is the homies. We have mutual homies and they telling us, oh, he's about to say this, da 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 da. And we like, well, we don't care about that. We busting. What I feel, I feel. But, you know, I think it was good for hip hop, good for Bay Area hip hop. You know, it got wild that night, but I mean, these is the homies, man. Yeah. Big up all them dudes, you know? So I'm glad that it went down. I'm sad that it went down in the way that it did, because I think that as far as we could have toured together, we could have, but beyond the lyrical beef, there was bad blood that, you know, escalated outside of that, that kept us from doing a lot of business together. So now when you look at the homie and he's in a bad physical state, you know, when this guy was a physical specimen, you know, like a solid dude, it's like, it's frustrating, because it's like, damn, we spent a lot of time angry at each other over some shit that really, it's just rap battles, you know? And I think that the good thing I like about sound clashes and grime is that them dudes battle, they go in on each other, but it doesn't spill out past that. Unfortunately for hip hop, and I don't know if it's because Americans just take themselves too seriously, or, you know, brothers got weird esteem issues and shit, we take this shit so seriously that sometimes it spills beyond. And at the point where we were then, things could have went way left. You know what I'm saying? It did go way left, really. And in hindsight, it's like, damn, this is the homie. We could have been doing a lot more business with him and business with each other. So that's frustrating. But all's well as ends well. I think we all have a good perspective on it. You know what I'm saying? The last time I physically saw Saphir, he was at Casual's album release for, I think He Still Think He Raw or Smash Rock, or one of those Casual albums. And it was all love. He was in a wheelchair, you know, and he was dealing with what he was dealing with. Still busted his rhymes though, you know? So it is what it is.
But it's all love now. So that's what's up, man. But you're right. Hip hop is, we do shit different, man. And it's sometimes it's not the best way, man. You know what I mean? We handle shit different. And basically what you're describing, and I read about it a lot in a lot of different places, you're describing something that basically went south really quick.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It just.
Oh, like a 10-day period. So it went from, this is my partner, I didn't even know he harbored these feelings towards us.
Fuck to, this nigga.
To, yeah, we about to let some shots off. You know what I'm saying? No, like, really, really not. And this is, he probably was, what, 23, 24? We was 19 at the time. You know what I'm saying? I think I was off some Christian brothers. Like, I don't drink or smoke or none of that. I was off some Christian brothers and probably a Titan. You know what I mean, though? To where mind state and all these other things happen, you know, that makes you go in a way that I don't think it would have even went in that way had we just been 4 or 5 years older. Just men, you know, like grown-ass men. We were kids at the time, you know?
Right. No, that makes sense. That makes sense. At least it's straight now. You know, I always like to end with my guests on some real shit, because the hip hop ain't real. I mean, it's important, but it ain't real. And there's a lot of stuff. 2020 is a ferocious year right now. And
memorable.
I guess we're gonna be in the history books, son. They go like 20 years later and be like, yo, you know. But so I really want to, you know, before we end up, I want to chat on some real shit. I mean, I did this with a couple other people that I interviewed. If Tajai were president, what would he do right now?
Oh, wow. That's a tough, I mean, let's just say that president has the power to actually do some shit. I would definitely make sure the rich pay taxes. You know, you got to think about it like Rockefeller and Vanderbilt and, you know, JP Morgan's and all those kind of dudes, they was at like a 94% tax rate. So they still balled as hard as they did, and they was paying 90-something% taxes back. And that's why we have all these streets and buildings and railroads named after these cats, because they money paid for it. So I would tax the rich. It's crazy that, you know, Amazon pays less taxes than me and you. You know, or Apple pays less, you know, Apple's based in Dublin, Ireland, you know, because they're trying to dip. So I would definitely make sure that the rich pay taxes. Not, I would, you know, hey, ball out as hard as you want. Just pay your fucking taxes like everybody else does. I would probably start working on sort of community-based policing, but that's sort of a local thing. You know, we've been at odds with the police here since the Panthers and probably before that. So it's all bad here. So I think that we definitely have to try a different approach, because what's happening ain't working. And then I would probably sort of use that tax money to I would definitely make community colleges free, you know, maybe not the four-year institutions or the private institutions, but at least community college. So if you wanted to get your education, you could go get a start for free and then matriculate and get a scholarship or whatever and be able to get your skills up. And I would do something like, I'm outside of my building right now, it's human feces. There are people living on the street. Oh man, it's bad. If you go on the back streets in Oakland, it looks like Thunderdome.
You're in Oakland.
It looks like Walker.
Your office is Oakland. Your office is in Oakland?
Yeah. All
oh, okay. I mean, I feel you then. All right.
Yeah. So, I mean, I'm saying outside though, it's. I mean, broken TVs. It looks like the Bronx in the beginning of hip hop. And so I would definitely figure out some sort of way to, first of all, do some kind of drug diversion so these cats don't end up on the streets in the first place, but some way to house and help these people out here. And I think that with those things, with, you know, I'd cut the military budget. You know, our military is 51 to 55% of our budget, right? So we're busy fighting wars and building McDonald's all over the planet when at home, like I said, it's human feces. Like, I stepped over boo-boo. Poo-poo, you know, not
all of this over boo-boo heads,
you know, in as I walked in my building, and I'm sitting here waiting for it to dry out so I can scoop it and get rid of it. You know what I'm saying?
Well,
so it's just like, it shouldn't be like this in the most prosperous country in the world. And so, yeah, so I would say, hey, make sure the rich are taxed and redistribute that wealth in sort of reforms. make sure that the military budget is cut and make it so that we don't have to have this military industrial complex in order for us to be the number one nation in the world. Make sure that education and healthcare are attainable for everybody. And then use some of that money for housing.
Yo, let's go back to this police shit for a minute, because that's obviously in the forefront of everyone's mind right now, because niggas is just taking golf club practice on niggas' heads right now. So what are they? Let me ask you a question. Are there good police out there?
Same way as good Crips out there.
You seem like a level-headed cat. So I just want to hear, like, you know what I'm saying? Tajai, the architect, fucking smart nigga. What are they good? Are there good Crips? Are there good cops out there?
There are good Crips out there too, right? There are good vice lords out there too.
I think so.
But they joined an organization that, at its essence, is about vice or cripping or whatever, you know what I'm saying, though? And at a certain point, they're going to have to ride on somebody who most likely looks just like them, probably grew up right around the corner from them, and it's going to be senseless, etc. And the way that they have to maintain what they do is by selling dope, robbing people, jacking, extortion, etc. So although it's probably blood members, gorilla blood, crazy wild, you know, peace stones, whatever, with hearts of gold, they joined up into an organization where the point of the organization is foul, inherently foul. I mean, the cops were made as slave catchers. You know what I'm saying, though? And that's the basis of their organization. So as a Negroid human, I can't honestly say there are. That doesn't mean I got homies that are cops. You know what I'm saying? We don't kick it because the same reason, you know, I got homies that are murderers. We don't hang out much. You know what I'm saying, though? Because I don't want to get shot up for some shit that they did. You know what I'm saying? Not because they're necessarily bad guys, just because what they're carrying with them is different. It's some different shit. And they signed up for it knowing that this is how they rock. So one bad apple spoils the bunch is the right. One rotten apple spoils the bunch is the whole idiom. So when you talk about a rotten apple, you can't just remove the rotten apple and everything. Nah, it's endemic. It's at its core, and we got to reform it completely. I haven't looked into police abolition enough to say, hey, we got to get rid of the cops completely. But I know that at its core, the police organization is not something that's going to help me out in my life. I know when things happen, if I make a police report, it's because I got to report the shit to insurance and they won't listen to it. Without a police report. If I have an issue, I call a wolf and they handle my issue. You feel what I'm saying, though? And that's really kind of how it is in my community, a Chinese community, the Jewish community, the Italian community, the Russian community, the Albanian community. You know what I'm saying, though? We call 5-0 because we have to have that official police report. But they janitors, man. They're not stopping crime. They come afterwards and mop up and observe and report.
Wow. So Tajai, who's doing well, living his life, a professional black man contributing to society, feels that in a situation you gotta call a goon, then call in someone from public service.
Absolutely.
Right now, you're telling me this. You're not saying this from like 15, 20 years ago. You're saying right now.
If something happened right now, I know exactly who I'm calling. And the numbers, there's no 9-1 or 1 in his phone number. You feel what I'm saying? And I know for sure I'm going to get
move
my shit recovered.
Move your camera back over a little bit.
Oh, my bad. Yeah, go. I'm saying, I know exactly who I'm calling. And I know that I'm most likely going to get my shit recovered. And I'm going to have a nice report just like I would from the police. And if there's a possibility of it being resolved without violence, it will be resolved without violence, because I'm not calling no young hothead. I'm calling somebody who I know handles this business and got eyes everywhere, etc. And so they're going to find what I need to find. They're going to bring it to me. If some resolution has to happen, they're going to bring me the person I need to resolve it with, and it's going to get handled. And that's not going to be the police. The police are going to probably come to my house and be like, oh, why is your window broken? What's up with this? Your tags, you know, your tags ain't right. They're going to ask me to snitch on my neighbors or something. You know what? Have you heard anything? A lot of this is going down in the community right now. Have you heard anything crazy?
Facts!
With regard to this house down the street, et cetera.
Facts,
so now I'm going to call my police.
Facts. and that's unfortunate, but it's facts. Listen, I didn't think you were going to say that, yo. And the fact that you told me that shit, you know, that shit sucks, man. I mean, I don't even know what to really fucking say. You know what I mean? That's trash, B. I got to fucking get that Swahili joint down. But that sucks. You know what I'm saying? That's the reality right now.
But that's always been the reality, man. Come on. In our community, the last person you want to call is the police, because you know everybody going down then, it's going to be all bad, because they're there to... When they pull you over, they're like, we got us a customer, because some bread is going to be broke. Either to the lawyers or to the cops or to both or to the court system. But no matter what, I don't see it positive. I mean, it's the same with guns. I have never seen a situation where the gun cooled it down. The gun heated it up. That don't mean I don't got guns. That just means I've never seen a situation where firearms, which are offense, they're for offense, not defensive weapons. I've never seen it calm down from there. It always goes up. So it's the same with police. I'm calling a hired gun, but the hired gun doesn't work for me, even though I do pay my taxes. The hired gun works for somebody who doesn't even want to see me on the chessboard, who can't wait to take both of us out. I got a buddy right now doing 72 to life for something he did not do. They know he didn't do it. He got into a gun battle with somebody else. That other person shot a bystander, right? Snitched, and now they both in jail. They tried them together. And he's doing 72 to life. So I'm like, man, I'm not involving no authorities whatsoever. That's not my thing. And this ain't no street code shit. I'm a square. I'm an L7. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like I said, I have on Birkenstocks right now. You know what I'm saying? So you feel me? It ain't like I'm trying to talk this street shit. I'm just keeping it 100.
Yeah, I don't like your 100, though. That sucks. I mean, I don't like it. I wish it was more like 50. You know what I'm saying? Like, I don't like that, son. I mean, like, that's some bullshit. But, yo, unfortunately, that's the fucking facts, man. And that sucks, yo. And, you know, I talked to my aunt. She was a cop. She just retired. She was a cop, L.A.
Uh-huh.
L.A. City. And I said, yo, like, why you can't just shoot a nigga in the leg if he does something, right? Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, just bust him in the leg and then it's over. Like, why you gotta kill the nigga? And she was like, she said, you know, this was a few years ago when I asked her. She said, well, the police is a paramilitary organization, and when we pull our weapons, we have to shoot to kill.
And I'm like, honestly,
that's a fucked up rule, though.
Nah, I'd be shooting. I am a gun collector, etc. If you talking about gunplay, unless you Robin Hood or some shit with your shit, shoot to kill, because you don't know that's just gun. That's what you taught. Anything that you point your gun at is going to die. You're planning to obliterate it. That doesn't mean that's what you want to do. But if you talk about gunplay, imagine somebody shoot at me, I'm shooting back. If I'm shooting back, I'm not shooting them in the leg, and that's how the cops think. Like, if I pull this thing out, it's gonna go. So that's the rule across the board with all.
I'm saying, hold up, y'all. Like, let's say, okay, like you got a dude, right? And he like, you like, stop running, or you know, drop your weapon, or I'll shoot.
Oh no, I'm not okay. I'm not justifying them using deadly force.
I'm saying, why can't you just me out? Bust a nigga in the ankle real quick.
Yeah, you know, but you can't, they're not that good. These dudes have 18 months of, you know, 18 weeks, 32 something weeks of training. And then
yeah, I don't like what you're telling me. We about to end this shit, nigga.
They're not that good. If they can shoot you in the ankle, I think some of them would. But I'm not justifying the use of deadly force. I'm saying the gun shouldn't be out. Knock him out with a billy club. You feel what I'm saying? Do it like the police. How is it that people in every other country, police in every other country, can subdue subjects with their hands and just, but then you look at the police in other countries, like if you go to the UK, the cops is bruisers out there. They look like bouncers. You know what I'm saying? No, you go to the Eastern Bloc countries. They swole. They look like bouncers.
Them niggas walking around like this, yo.
Yep, no net. And they ride around six deep in vans or whatever. You go to Eastern Bloc countries, maybe one dude got the yapper with him, but the other guys is just out there looking like well-trained, well-oiled machines. Like, they're not eating donuts and all that kind of shit.
These guys out here,
I mean, it's a job. We can't expect them all to be marksmen, but don't pull out, how can I explain it? the gun shouldn't be out in the first place. You know what I'm saying, though? And if you scare, look at the people who joined the police. There's no disrespect to your honor or whatever, but the people who joined the police department, the ones that I know, that I went to school with and shit, that I see, they was busters. They was busters. Like, and now they swole up and, hey, T, how you doing? And I'm like, man, I don't fuck with you. Yeah, I never fucked with you. So I can't really, you see what I'm saying, though? The people who sign up for that are a certain type of person. And that type of person is often somebody who's scared enough to use a gun, pull out a gun on you and use it in that situation. Right. But if the thing is out, yo, center mass, double tap, center mass. I'm not even shooting at the head. I'm not going to shoot at the head because I'm not that good. But I'm definitely trying to hit that center mass. I'm not trying to wing you because then you might be able to get to me.
Got you. I got you. And I understand. And I get it. I get it. I didn't want to hear that shit from you, though.
The use of force that we're seeing is way OD. Like, it's over the top. So I'm like, we see these exact same situations with people who are not black, and they leave. They live to walk away, and they're always talking about, oh, this guy's he was resisting this, that, the third. We see white boys slap the shit out of cops, push them down, spit on them, knock their coffee out of their hands, call them everything but a child of God. Hop back in their car, which is a deadly weapon, which is a 2-ton, 4-ton deadly weapon, and still end up just getting a little ticket or maybe a piece of that. So it's not like, I think there's this weird concept that we are like the Hulk or some kind of special beings. And there's also this concept that we are less than human. And that's where the whole our lives mattering comes out of, is that why are y'all treating us worse than you would treat a pet or just like you would treat a rabid dog? When we're just beings, we're just regular beings. And this goes for the white boys being shot too, and the Latinos being shot, and the Asians being shot too. They should be outraged as well. But for some reason, black people, we are always the tip of the spear when it comes to issues that revolve around human rights. And it's probably because we get treated the least human out of all the humans, shit, worldwide.
Hard to argue with that shit. We're going to end it on a song in a couple of minutes to fucking uplift the mood a little bit. But it's always important. Listen, as I say, though, this to me, that part of the conversation is more important than the other shit, man. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, that's what really matters. Next week's guest, quick announcement, couple announcements. Next week's guest, Pause One. You know what I'm saying? SoCal, fucking big up Pause One. We're going to have him on. We got a fucking bunch of people coming up. Juju, Terminology, Bernadette Price. And as you said, you're going to help me get some Hieroglyphics interviews. So
yes, sir. We can
track
down
OPO, wherever the fuck he's at, and other cats. So Break Me Loose on. He's been chopping it up. Maybe we can get Break Me Loose for an interview too. So got Tajai, Souls of Mischief. This is that feel good. Your videos are so dope, by the way, man. The outdoors.
You'll never know, from 93 to the village, we've been inventing, creating the bomb. I only get sent a minute, been a long time since I feel I've been fat. But the only thing I fear is fear itself. So you know what we got to do? Maybe could we keep it within the groove, like it should be? Never giving out, we living out our dreams. If it's something I can't live without, that's my team. You never know. Hieroglyphics, hip-hop is vintage. Underground like silo, wanting long range ballistics. World renowned, we groundbreaking. Musical boundaries running circles around and sits. Oh.
We got Tajai coming up with Coochie Rap soon. Everybody that was just in here, that shit, Tajai Coochie Rap soon, he sent it to me. And you can't hear it now.
We can live in ways that many thought was lost. In this contemporary maze of methods to floss, we find the trees and trails that lay boundaries to cross. We can live down beyond the bounds of reason. Or earthbound, beating up the Coliseum.
They rush the stage full throttle in Chicago. Our brains interlock. We're begging MCs get caught.
We're going to say goodbye to Tajai. We're going to do this again.
Yeah.
Stay in touch. I'm going to listen to that joint as soon as I get up.
Yeah, check it out. Let me know what you think.
Yo, thank you very much.
Love.
I appreciate you.
Oh, homie. Yeah, I appreciate you too, my brother.
Tajai and the Birkenstocks. Hieroglyphics. Salute. I'll tag you and all this shit. We'll get this up. We'll chop it up. Appreciate you, man.
Yes, sir.
All right, be good.
All right, one love.